Should we start?
Yes, ma, we'll start.
Okay, history. We are starting the history part. It's given by self, patient, it's reliable. Mr. XYZ, 41-year-old male, right-handed, presented with chief complaints of difficulty in standing from sitting position for past 15 years, slippage of slippers with awareness for past 11 years, and difficulty in raising arms above shoulders for past 9 years.
Yes, ma'am. Go
HOPI, a
on.
patient was apparently normal 25 years back because he was able to walk to school when he was young, which was approximately 2 kilometers away from his home. And at 25 years of age, this was the first time that he noticed difficulty in standing from sitting position. While they used to have puja at their home, so he used to take support of the wall to stand. This was when he was at 25 years of age. And afterwards, that is after 2 years, he also noticed difficulty in climbing stairs, and he used to take support of the handle of the stairs. This is climbing up, and then subsequently afterwards, he developed difficulty in going downstairs. Then later on, he required support of one person to make him stand from sitting position. Previously, he was able to stand by himself, but with minimal support of the wall. Now, approximately after 6.5 years, he is now requiring one person support to make him stand from sitting position. And there's multiple history of falls due to buckling of both the knees. Currently, he takes support of the stick and a wall to walk. Afterwards, he required two-person support to make him stand from sitting position. And at 30 years of age, he noticed difficulty in gripping the slippers and had multiple complaints of slippage of slippers. But he was able to sense that he's wearing the slippers and that they have slipped, but he was not able to grab them. At 32 years of age, there is difficulty in lifting rice bag above his head. And subsequently, he noticed that he is not able to open a cap of bottle, which is a bottle of oil at his home, and he currently requires assistance for the same. And he also noticed difficulty in turning in bed from side to side, with difficulty in sitting from supine position. And while sitting, he noticed that his head lags behind the rest of the body when he tries to sit from supine. And at 38 years of age, he wasn't able to raise his hand above the shoulders to bathe, to lift the cup of mug of water while bathing. There was no problem with buttoning and unbuttoning of the shirt at this moment, and he noticed thinning of muscles of upper and lower limb both. Upper limb, he said, only forearm muscles, and the lower limb, mostly the distal muscles. Different history apart from the motor complaints. At 32 years of age, there is history of decrease in vision, which was there for 6 months. Afterwards, he got it checked up, and there was no signs of diplopia as per the history part, but he was diagnosed to have cataract, and both the eyes are operated now. He also said that he has inability to close his eyes when he tries to sleep at night, but he is able to protrude his tongue out and move from side to side. There's no history of loss of sensation. He's able to perceive hot and cold temperature while bathing, and he's able to feel vibration. Like, for an example, the mobile phone in his pocket, he was able to sense that it's vibrating. There's no complaint of bowel bladder involvement. And 8 years back, he also noticed that he has difficulty in releasing the bottle cap while he was trying to open it. But otherwise, negative part, there's no history suggestive of exposure to any drugs or toxins, no history suggestive of passage of cola-colored urine or hematuria, no history of rash, no history of pain in bilateral thigh and bilateral arm, and no history suggestive of difficulty in naming or suggestive of any other cognitive decline.
Okay, ma'am. We'll start one by one.
Okay.
Symptoms.
Okay,
Why
ma'am. No
don't
problem.
you start the first symptom? First symptom of your patient, examination will come to later, I think. Now we'll finish the symptom analysis.
Okay,
First
ma'am.
symptom is getting up from the sitting posture, you told, no?
Yes, ma'am.
So what exactly was the difficulty he experienced while getting up from the sitting posture?
Ma'am, he was able to initiate the movement, but he was not able to gain the strength to do so. He required support of the wall, nearby wall, to stand.
Also, Was the semiology of getting up changed, ma? Because getting up from the sitting posture be impaired due to non-neurological conditions as well as neurological conditions. Non-neurological may be joints, ligaments, tendons, or neurological may be LMN or UMN. So all are possible, no? So
yes,
when he says like that, first symptom you will tell my patient did not have any pain or limitation of movements while getting. If you all your you have got a juvenile rheumatoid arthritis or something like that, then your joints are jammed, you are not able to move, and many people become bed bound. No.
Yes, ma'am.
So one word, it is not painful. Okay.
Okay.
Second, what exactly was the semiology? We want to know. When you describe that symptom, that is called symptom analysis, whether the limb was flail or stiff. Was it flail or stiff?
No, it was not stiff, ma'am.
It was not stiff.
No, ma'am.
So it's a flail limb. Then
yes,
we know that it is not painful, so it is not due to probably joints or ligaments. And it is a flail limb, so it may be LMN, we don't know. It may be neurological and it may be LMN. If it is LMN, which part of the LMN? We have to analyze, no?
Yes, ma'am.
So it is confined to the lower limb at that point of time.
Yes, ma'am, at that point of time, lower limb.
Yes, then we ask some questions to know which part of the lower limb was affected. What are all the agonist muscles for standing up from the sitting posture? That is the problem, no? Can you tell me the agonists which are acting while you are standing up from the sitting posture? They are the spine extensors, hip extensors, knee extensors, and dorsiflexors of the ankle.
Yes, ma'am.
So these are the agonist. Antagonist are the corresponding muscles. That is the spine flexor, the
yes,
knee
ma'am.
Flexors, and plantar flexors of the ankle, and the hip flexor. They are the antagonist. Whereas the adductors and abductors are the synergist and fixator. So for any movement, you have got agonist, you have got antagonist, you have got synergist and fixator. Mainly, if the first symptom is difficult in getting it, we concentrate on the agonist. So if it was a flail limb, it could be due to spine extensor, it could be due to hip extensor, it could be due to knee extensor, or it could be dorsiflexor of the ankle.
Yes,
so
ma'am.
How each one of them will manifest is the symptom that will elicit from the patient. If it is spine extensor patient, it came much later. You told he's not able to turn in the bed later.
Yes, ma'am.
If it is spine extensor, patient will tell that he will be able to draw the legs below his thighs while he is sitting on the floor, but he will not be able to elevate his trunk. So somebody will have to pull him up, then he will stand up. That is spine extensor. If the spine extensor is normal and hip extensor is weak, then the typical semiology will be there, where the spine extensor is originating from the iliac crest. So what will the patient do is, patient will try to elevate the hip with the help of erector spinae. So if erector spinae has to be used to lift the hip, he cannot use it to lift the spine. He cannot use it to erect the spine. Are you following, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am.
So what he will do, he will bend. Patient will bend forward. Normally, we get up end block with our pelvis down. Our pelvis will be down and we get up end block. You can imagine how we get up from the floor. We draw our legs below the thighs, put our hands on the side and lift the trunk. The trunk will be above and pelvis will be below.
Yes, ma'am.
Here is a situation where the spine extensor is normal, but hip extensor is weak. So patient is using the erector spinae's attachment to the iliac crest to elevate the pelvis. So he will switch off the erector spinae from elevating the trunk. So he will bend forward and hip will be pulled up. So that is called as hip up sign. So that will be the first sign. So if you ask, how did you get up, sir? Then he will say, somehow it was very different. I have to bend my trunk. Then you get the clue. It's a proximal muscle weakness. It's a hip up sign. So after that hip up, what happens? The pelvis will be on the top. We can never imitate that. If you have a normal spine extensor, you cannot imitate that movement at all. So Patient bends forward and hip is at the top. That is called hip up sign. After that, he will go into a posture called tripod sign. Now you have locked your joints with the cruciate ligament. And he can stand. Now he wants to walk, no? So yes, he will try to stabilize his leg on the ligaments and slowly elevate his trunk. How he will do that? He will first put one hand on the floor and one hand on one leg. So that is tripod. One hand is on the floor and two legs are on the floor. That is called tripod. At this point, patient's leg is supported by bones and ligaments, not the muscles. Then he will lift the other hand and put it on the other leg and climb up like that. That is called Gower sign. So if that is there, hip up sign is there, followed by tripod sign, then Gower sign is there. You know, it is the glutei that is affected. It is a hip extensor that is affected. It's a fly limb according to us. So it's a hip extensor if this semiology is there. If it is a knee extensor, patient will draw the leg under the thigh. He will put the hands on the side, elevate the trunk, and he will stand also. But when he stands, he will buckle. Or he will feel that the knee is unstable. That is knee extensor. So first two parts are not there. There is no hip up. There is no tripod. There is no Gower's. He stands up, but is unstable at the knee and falls down, buckles and falls. Third will be the dorsiflexor of the ankle. So if the dorsiflexor of the ankle is affected, every step will be all right. He will not buckle also. But when he stands, he will find that his ankle is wobbling. And when he is elevating the trunk to put the weight on the ankle, generally, they try to fix the ankle with their hands during one phase of getting up. So if this history has been elicited, we will know that somewhere is the disease started where, we will be able to know. But that exact history we did not get. So we will think it could be any of these muscles because the semiology is not available to us. So it could be spine extensor, it could be hip extensor, it could be knee extensor or dorsiflexor of the ankle. We need a little more information to localize. But you said that the second symptom was buckling, no?
Yes, ma'am. Buckling was there later on.
So after the getting up from the sitting, the buckling came or slipping of chappal came? You said it is slipping of chappal, no? Is it so?
After slippage, ma'am, it came.
So second symptom is slippage.
Yes,
so
ma'am.
First symptom, we have analyzed the phenomenology, but localization we are not getting in this case because we have not got all the information that we need. No, so we'll keep it like that. Any one of them is affected. Next, we might make us wiser. You said that slipping of chappal with knowledge. No.
Yes, ma'am.
So would you like to analyze that more?
Ma'am, if it's with knowledge, it means sensation is intact, but the motor part is the problem here.
Definitely. So it's the motor part. In the motor part, what are all the things that can produce slipping? It can be again upper motor neuron. That's a clinical discussion we will reinforce. It can be upper motor neuron, it can be lower motor neuron. So that is the point that you will elicit from your patient. If it is upper motor neuron, what is it that gets affected, ma'am? The word used is called kinetic melody. Kinetic melody, heard, no? It's the beauty or music of a motor activity. That is a fine coordination or fine tuning of all these muscles. As I told, agonist, antagonist, synergist, fixator are there. So they should be fine tuned so that when you put your chappal in your feet, your toes will give space. Once the chappal is incorporated, the toes will come down. And when you want to walk, the toes will come down and remain approximated with the slipper. And when you want to remove the chappal, the toes will separate. So these are the things that needs fine tuning of adduction and abduction at the level of the toes. So kinetic melody will be lost in upper motor neuron disease. So if your patient says, sir, when I have to put my feet into the chappal, some of the toes are coming in between. So I use my fingers and I put it like that. When I want to hold on and walk, some of the fingers are overriding, giving way, chappal is slipping. and then I want to remove, again they are troubling, so I use my fingers. Then you know all the three phases, that is putting on the chappal, holding on and walking, and removing the chappal, are all affected. That means fine tuning of the movement has failed. So like typing movement in the upper limb, so that means upper motor neuron. We don't know whether it's a stiff limb or the fly limb. So imagining it is a anything, no? If it is a fly limb, if it is lower motor neuron, which structure is involved? Which muscle is involved more? So if it is upper motor neuron, did you understand? All three faces will be affected.
Yes,
he cannot put on the chappal. The fingers will come in between. He cannot hold on and walk. It will slip off. And when he wants to remove the chappal, again the toes will come in between. So again he has to use the hand. That is upper motor neuron. Supposing it is lower motor neuron, would you like to tell me the muscle involved, ma? It's the indrashi. It's the indrashi, no? It is the indrashi muscle which is helping to bring the toes together. So the toes always remain separated. The indrashi are wasted and weak. So the toes remain separated. So when the patient wants to put the feet into the chappal, it is so easy because the space is so much is there. But he cannot bring it together to hold the chappal. And when he wants to remove the chappal also, it is easy. So if the patient is telling, I am able to put the chappal very easily, but I cannot hold on and walk. But when I want to remove my chappal, again, I don't need the help of my hands. That means it is indrashi, it is lower motor neuron. So could you get any information on this, ma? Did the patient say anything about this?
It was definitely, he didn't have any difficulty in putting on and off, but it used to slip after he tries to wear the slipper.
So in that case, it is probably lower motor neuron.
Yes,
so
ma'am.
That point you should highlight and tell. My patient could put on easily. He could not hold on and walk. He could remove easily. So probably at the distal, it is a lower motor neuron. It is a indrashi which have been probably involved. Then he had a difficulty in raising the arm above the shoulder for 9 years. No?
Yes,
so what are all the muscles involved in raising the shoulder above the arm?
Subscapularis, supraspinatus, deltoid.
So first 30 degrees is supraspinatus. Next 30 degrees up to 90 degrees, 30 to 90 degrees is deltoid. Beyond 90 degrees is trapezius. Subscapularis, what does it do, ma? It does internal rotation of the adducted shoulder. So subscapularis is an internal rotator of the adducted shoulder. When the shoulder is kept adducted, it will rotate the shoulder internally. So first 30 degrees, if it is difficult, my patient will tell, I will have to support my arm for the first part, then I can lift it up. Then you know it is supraspinatus. If he says, no, throughout, I am unable to lift it at all, at any plane, even if I help for the first 30 degrees, that means it may be supraspinatus followed by deltoid and plus minus trapezius. So throughout the range, he had difficulty in lifting the arm above the shoulder means it may be supraspinatus plus deltoid, plus minus trapezius, that we'll have to confirm all the throughout the range. So apparently from the history of a fly limb, difficulty in getting up from the sitting posture, followed by slippage of chappal with knowledge and only in the second phase of chappal and lifting the shoulder, it looks like a limb girdle syndrome. Proximal limb girdle syndrome to start with and later distal. So started proximally in the lower limb, went on to the distal part, and then involved the proximal part of the upper limb also. So some kind of a purely motor syndrome in a limb girdle pattern is this much. Next, you said that he was buckling, climbing. So you said that climbing up was difficult to start with. This was followed by difficulty in climbing down, no?
Yes, ma'am.
Would you like to expand this symptom? What was the problem in climbing up?
Climbing up, ma'am, he was able to initiate the movement, like he was able to keep the limb on the first stair. And
okay.
Then when he had to support his body to go it up, to move it upwards, then he had difficulty.
In that case, what muscle is normal? He had no difficulty in initiating climbing up. What are you conveying to me by that, ma? In a fly limb, in a stiff limb, everything will be affected if there is stiffness. In a fly limb, he was able to initiate the climbing up. Means what? Which muscle is normal? Apparently normal. Iliopsoas.
Iliopsoas.
So iliopsoas initiates the climbing. Yes, that will help us to put the feet on the step above. That part is all right.
Yes,
but the second part is lifting the pelvis.
Yes,
that is glutei. And third part is stabilizing the limb with the Tendelenburg effect. That is gluteus medius and minimus.
Yes,
so probably the iliopsoas is better and gluteus maximus and medius and minimus might have been affected. If it is a gluteus maximus alone, patient will say, I can put my leg on the step above, but I am unable to lift my hip. But once I lift my hip, I can cushion and climb up. But if he says that when I am lifting my hip, my leg on that side sinks down, that means gluteus medius and minimus is also affected. And that is called what sign?
Tendelenburg.
Tendelenburg effect, that sign while climbing is called hip dip sign. Because that hip normally what happens, it goes up. Instead of going up, it is dipping down. So it is called hip dip sign. Understood, ma? So if it is iliopsoas, he will lift his leg with a hand and put it on the step above. Then he is able to climb. That means iliopsoas is weak, others are all right. If iliopsoas is normal and hip extensor is weak, he'll be able to initiate climbing, but he'll not be able to lift the thigh. For that, he will hold on to the side rail. That alone is the problem is gluteus maximus. He is holding on to the side rail and that hip on that side is going down. The Tendelenburg effect is happening. That means gluteus medius and minimus is also weak. So apparently this climbing up difficulty confirms that patient has a proximal muscle weakness in the lower limb. Climbing down is better to start with, you told, no?
Yes, ma'am. So initially, it was better. Climbing up is the first issue.
Yes. What condition climbing down is difficult to start with? Supposing somebody is telling, I could climb up all right, sir. No, not much problem when I started. But climbing down was giving me trouble initially. Later, I became worse in all planes. If it is a reverse complaint, what will be the inference you will draw?
PSP. If we start from top.
PSP patients, it is not climbing up or down, but they will not be able to fix their gaze due to eye movement problem. So they may hold the head in a peculiar position. Otherwise, climbing down produces more disability in the leg, means it is lumbar canal stenosis. Neurogenic claudication. You know, there is neurogenic claudication, no? Some patient is having neurogenic claudication due to congenital lumbar canal stenosis, or he is having listhesis. That situation, when he bends, climbs down, the trunk becomes bent. So the nerve roots become stretched. So to start with, if the climbing down is more difficult, you in a patient who has some kind of walking problem, you will consider lumbar canal stenosis. Climbing up is difficult, proximal muscle weakness. Both climbing up and climbing down is weakness. It is a stiff limb. A stiff limb, both climbing up and down will be difficult. Only to start with, climbing up is more difficult is a proximal muscle. Climbing down is more difficult is neurogenic claudication. So again, we feel that our patient's problem started in the proximal muscles. Probably it is not the iliopsoas, it is the glutei plus minus gluteus medius and minimus. And later he had the distal muscles in the lower limb and proximal muscles of the upper limb were involved. Next symptom, you told that he had buckling. No, next symptom you told me
yes,
that he was buckling. So how do you, and he had repeated falls due to buckling. No?
Yes, ma'am.
So how will you describe a buckling patient, ma'am? Forget about this patient. You see, elicitation of history depends on the symptom. This particular patient, he says he is buckling. But when somebody is telling buckling, what all questions you will ask?
Ma'am, unilateral or bilateral?
Yes. What is the importance, ma'am? What is the importance of knowing whether the buckling is unilateral or bilateral? Very good answer. Tell me, ma'am.
Ma'am, unilateral means localized. It mostly points towards any joint pathology or tendon or local issue.
Okay, it can be joint, then it will be painful buckling.
Painful, yes.
If it is due to unilateral painful buckling, it will be cruciate ligament or semilunar cartilage. Agreed. Any other unilateral? It can be plexopathy, diabetic amyotrophy. No, you are having patients, a lot of diabetics are there. Say they have a diabetic amyotrophy, or those people have lumbosacral plexopathy, or some tumor infiltrating into the lumbosacral plexus, hemophilia patients bleeding into the lumbosacral plexus, cold abscess, no?
Yes,
seeping into the lumbosacral plexus, all these things are there. So if it is a unilateral painful buckling, you will think of cruciate ligament or semilunar cartilage. If it is a unilateral painless buckling, you will think of unilateral conditions like lumbosacral plexopathy due to various causes. It may be hemorrhage, it can be abscess, or it can be a diabetic plexopathy, or it can be idiopathic demyelination. So that is one group of conditions. Then it may have an L3 radiculopathy. L3 is then root supply to the quadriceps. So if there is a L3 root involvement due to a neurofibroma, or it can be due to an unusual disc disease, or some osteomyelitis of the vertebra through which the nerve root is coming. So that is L3. So unilateral painful will be joint, painless will be lumbosacral plexopathy or L3 radiculopathy. So you will want to know whether it is unilateral or bilateral. Second. Good answer. Second.
Ma'am, then painful or painless?
Very good. That is the third point. Agreed. Next. Is it a stiff buckling or a flail buckling? You'll want to know, is it a stiff buckling or a flail buckling? Because in upper motor neuron also, people will buckle. Cervical compressive myelopathy, people will buckle. They buckle because, again, the same phenomenon of kinetic malady. Co-contraction and co-relaxation. That is otherwise called positive and negative supporting reaction. In the physiological terms, we call it as positive and negative supporting reaction. Normally, there is no co-contraction. Agonist will contract, antagonist will relax. So when the kinetic malady is lost, there will both agonist and antagonist will contract together. And both agonist and antagonist will give way together. So you have buckling because of co-contraction of agonist and antagonist followed by co-relaxation in upper motor. So it's a stiff buckling, pyramidal disease. Flail buckling is because of the inability to stabilize the joint by the quadriceps. So if it is a flail buckling, you know it's an element problem. It's a stiff buckling, you know that it is a EMN problem. Next, any other additional points you'll ask, ma'am? Other situations where people can buckle. You heard a condition called cataplexy?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
A sudden emotional surge will cause fall.
Yes. Heavy meal, emotional surge, physical activity. Without knowing what happened, he will find himself just fallen like a log of bag of muscles, and then he gets up. In that case, you will ask whether he is having any narcolepsy, is he having sleep attacks, which they may not tell. They may not tell because they will think that if he's sleeping in an odd situation, he will think that he's a wrong person, very lazy. No? Sleep paralysis, hypnagogic hallucinations, all those things they may not tell us. Only the cataplexy may be told. So it may be cataplexy. Any other condition, ma? Hydrocephalic buckling is there, and you have got drop attacks. No? These are other situations where people look like buckling. Hydrocephalic buckling is supposing you have got a colloid cyst of the third ventricle or aqueduct obstruction, and the leg fibers are in the interhemispheric region. In the homunculus, the leg is in the interhemispheric region. So when there is a valve-like obstruction to the third ventricle by a pedunculated colloid cyst, then what happens is, whenever there is a blockage, the frontal horn dilates and the leg fibers are jammed. So patient will fall down. When it happens in pedunculated lesions, typically colloid cyst or valve-like obstruction. So when the cyst moves away, it will go away and he will get up. That is called hydrocephalic buckling, where patient might experience mild incontinence, slight disorientation. That is hydrocephalic buckling, and there is something called drop attacks, which happens in elderly people. Sudden loss of postural tone with immediate writing and retained consciousness. It is supposed to be due to top of the basilar ischemia, where the crust cerebri or the cerebral peduncles, peduncular branches, when the peduncular branches go into ischemia due to top of the basilar artery ischemia, it is otherwise called one of the manifestations of Kaplan syndrome. It is called Kaplan syndrome. Then the crust cerebri goes into ischemia, transient ischemia, they fall down and they get up. That is one kind of drop attack, and there is also idiopathic drop attack in the elderly. So these are the various causes for buckling. Our patient is buckling on both knees and it is painless. He's already having weakness of gluteus maximus, gluteus medius and minimus and the small muscles. So now we can infer that the quadriceps is also affected. So in this case, following through the history. Next, you said he has no buttoning. Notice thinning of muscles of forearm and lower limb. So why did you say thinning, ma?
Ma'am, thinning here signifies atrophy of the muscles.
Yes. Why did you not use the term wasting? What is the difference between thinning and wasting? Thinning is, supposing you have got fever or typhoid fever or something like that. You are not eating properly, you become thin. But you don't become weak. You become tired, but you don't become weak. So you can button, you can mix your food, you can comb your hair. So wasting means loss of bulk with loss of power. So that power of the small muscles of the hand, were they normal? If it is normal, you will say that it is thinning. My patient became thin. It is not having serious pathological relevance. He will become all right when he eats well. That is thinning. Whereas wasting is, power is also lost. So he is unable to mix food. He has difficulty in screwing. He has difficulty in using the pen. That means it is wasting. So did he have distal muscle weakness?
Yes, ma'am. We have mentioned previously while opening the cap of the bottle. Yeah.
Yes, then you should be using the term not thinning, wasting. Yes, all these words are well defined only. So your patient had wasting of the distal muscles. What else, ma? And 32 years, you have decreased.
The bilateral cataract operated.
Yes. Okay.
And inability to close his eyes when trying to sleep.
Oh, inability to close his eyes there. Inability to close eyes. What else, ma? Can he swallow?
Yes, ma'am, he is able to swallow. No dysphagia.
Okay. He is able to keep his head up. Huh? You told something with reference to head, no?
Yes, ma'am. While trying to get in sitting position from supine, he had difficulty. But even if they were managed to do it, his head lags behind the body.
It's lagged behind. Okay. Then now tell me, what are the muscles which are helping you to close your eyes?
Orbicularis oculi and levator palpebrae superioris.
So what does the levator palpebrae superioris do? It opens the eye. Orbicularis oculi closes the eye. So your patient has got difficulty in opening the eye or closing the eye?
Closing the eye, ma'am.
He is unable to close.
Yes,
that
ma'am.
Means it is orbicularis oculi.
Oculi.
Orbicularis oculi is supplied by which nerve?
From third.
Seventh nerve, no? Orbicularis oculi is supplied by the seventh nerve. Levator is supplied by third nerve.
Third nerve.
Third nerve. So that is all right. So then immediately you will ask, what about the other muscles supplied by the facial nerve? Can he buckle his chief? So when there is a muscle which is supplied by the seventh nerve is weak, you will ask about, elicit symptoms about other muscles supplied by the seventh nerve. Can he blow his cheek? Does food leak through the sides? When he is chewing, is the food remaining in the gutters? And he has to use fingers to pull it to the floor of the mouth. Are all those things all right?
There is no difficulty in swallowing as such, but sometimes he has difficulty in mastication.
Mastication?
Yes, ma'am.
What is the difficulty, ma'am?
not able to chew, ma'am, properly.
So what are the muscles involved in chewing?
Ma'am, masseter, pterygoids, temporalis.
Yes, they are supplied by which nerve?
Fifth, ma'am.
Yes. So among the, what about the sensations of the face?
Facial, no sensation, there was no complaint.
So now if you want to tell about the cranial nerves, you can say that orbicularis oculi is affected.
Yes, ma'am.
Then muscles of mastications are affected.
Yes, ma'am.
But other muscles supplied by the seventh nerve is not affected.
No,
and sensory component of the fifth nerve is not affected.
No, ma'am.
Then you told that his head lag behind.
Yes, ma'am.
Head lag means which muscle is powerful, which are the neck extensors, ma'am? Can you name the neck extensors? Name some of the neck extensor. Lag means extension. Leg, head is going into extension. No. So we will use this opportunity to revise which are the neck extensors.
And splenius capitis.
Very good.
Splenius cervicis.
Very good.
Rectus capitis.
Yes. So splenius capitis, longissimus capitis, splenius coli. And upper fibers of the erector spinae and some support from the trapezius. So neck is supported on the dorsal aspect by upper fibers of the trapezius, upper fibers of the erector spinae, longissimus capitis, longissimus coli, splenius capitis. These are the main muscles. So these are extensors. They are extending the neck. That
yes,
means which muscle are the flexors? Can it? They are weak. No, in the eye we found orbicularis oculi is weak. Muscles of mastication are weak. In the neck, which muscle is weak? That is the flexors. So can you name the flexors, ma'am?
Ma'am, support is by sternocleidomastoid and trapezius.
Very good. So the strongest flexor is sternocleidomastoid. Agreed. Trapezius, no. Trapezius is on the dorsal side. So agonist for flexion is sternocleidomastoid. What other muscle, ma'am?
And supportive can be by suprahyoid, infrahyoid.
Then, ribbon muscles you heard of? So primarily, neck flexion is by sternocleidomastoid. That's the strongest neck flexor. It is assisted by?
Longus capitis.
Ribbon muscles, no, ribbon muscles,
yes,
of the neck, no. Plus you have got sternothyroid, sternohyoid, thyrohyoid, omohyoid. So ribbon muscles are sternothyroid, sternohyoid, thyrohyoid, and omohyoid. So these muscles, so sternomastoid and the ribbon muscles are probably weak. So in the neck, there is flexors more than extensors. In the eye, ocular muscles. And in the muscles of mastications are affected. So now tell me the structures involved in this patient. Summarize, ma'am. At the end of the history, it is the gluteus maximus, medius, minimus, quadriceps, distal muscles in that order in the lower limb, proximal, maybe all abductors, and distal in the upper limb. And then you have got ocular muscles and masseter and neck flexors. So they are symmetrically involved, is it so? Are they symmetrically involved? Or
yes,
is there any symmetrically?
Symmetrically.
So at this point of time, it's a purely motor disorder, no?
Yes, ma'am.
So pure motor syndromes can be categorized into, so supposing a person comes with a pure motor syndrome. Let us keep the cataract ahead. No? We will consider the other condition, other pattern, muscle pattern. So it's
yes,
a pure motor syndrome. What are the possibilities, ma?
UMN versus LMN first will rule out.
Now it is LMN, no? You have got
LMN. Wasting. Yes, ma'am.
Your limb is flying. So pure motor LMN started proximally and then went on distally.
Yes, ma'am.
It can be muscle.
Myopathy or junction, ma'am? Pure motor.
So it can be muscle. It can be myoneural junction. It can be anterior horn cell or it can be mitochondria because ocular muscles are involved.
Yes,
ocular muscles are involved, you have to think of mitochondrial also. So is it a anterior horn cell disease? Is it a muscle disease? Is it a myoneural junction disease? Or is it a mitochondrial disease? These are the questions, no?
Yes, ma'am.
So how to differentiate?
Mitochondrial diseases will have family history and yes. predominant.
Maybe, no, they can have. Yes, we are considering mitochondrial because of involvement of the ocular muscles, no?
Yes, ma'am.
So we are thinking, so typically mitochondrial diseases will have fluctuations because okay. it's an energy deprived state. So when you exert, they may deteriorate. During febrile situations, they may deteriorate. Diagonal fluctuation will not be there, not there.
Yes, ma'am.
Whereas fever, during fever, during physical exertion, they may deteriorate. They can have some degree of encephalopathy. They can have associated RP and optic atrophy. See? And family history may be there. Classical family histories, multiple abortions in the family. So those things are there. You may consider mitochondrial disease. So that is one group. Neuromuscular junction, demonstrable fatigability. Supposing the patient says that after walking some distance, I am unable to walk at all for some 30 minutes, then somebody has to lift me up. But what are all the points against neuromuscular junction?
Ma'am, there is no other bulbar involvement.
No, wasting.
Wasting is there.
Neuromuscular junction disease, wasting will be seen in congenital myasthenia, not in acquired myasthenia. So this person's symptom became manifest after the age of 15. So congenital myasthenic syndromes are there where you can have wasting. Otherwise, late onset myasthenia, you do not get wasting. And that too, distal involvement. So distal involvement does not happen. Limb girdle myasthenia is there. Limb girdle myasthenia is there. It is more common with some kind of antibody like anti-musk. But classical myasthenia starts in the oculobulbar muscles and goes on to involve the proximal muscles. And distal muscles will not be involved. There will be demonstrable fatigability. Not that patient telling, I am tired, but a definite drop in the grade after exertion will be demonstrable. And distal muscle involvement and wasting does not happen in myasthenia. So myasthenia is less likely because distal wasting also is a and very significant distal weakness early in the course in the form of chapel slipping. So myasthenia is totally out. Mitochondrial, we will keep it as plus minus. We do not know. Then what about SMS? Proximal type of motor neuron disease, which manifests typically in this age group, spinal muscular atrophy, type 4, where it manifests in these 15, 16 years. No? What yes, will ma'am. Be the features, ma'am?
Ma'am, no sensory involvement.
So that is why. So these are all pure motor conditions.
Yes, ma'am.
That is why we are considering it as a differential diagnosis. It will be proximal.
Proximal.
SMS will be proximal. Distal is not there. Second yes, point, distal is less common. Unlike the adult type of MND, where the distal also gets involved. The classical SMA is proximal. Second, you may have tremors in the limbs. Third, you get wasting and weakness proportionate. Whereas in muscle disease, wasting is less and weakness is more. In SMS, wasting and weakness is proportionate. Fourth point, you may have fibrillations, whereas that is not seen in muscle disease. You might find segmental hypertrophy and segmental atrophy and pseudo hypertrophy in muscle disease. Whereas in SMA, it is very, very uncommon, rarely hypertrophy is reported, but it's not at all common. So wasting and weakness proportionate. There is tremors, fasciculations, and you may have no pseudo hypertrophy, no segmental atrophy, no segmental hypertrophy, and extensor digitorum brevis will be wasted, and there is flat foot. Whereas muscle disease, there is weakness more than wasting because there is some degree of hypertrophy. Segmental atrophy and segmental hypertrophy can be there, and usually it is a tendo-Achilles contracture, not flat foot. And most of the reflexes are absent, but Angle jerk is retained till late in most of the muscle diseases. And extensor digitorum brevis will be hypertrophic. So these are the four DDs, whether it is SMA, whether it is muscle disease, whether it is a neuromuscular junction or mitochondrial. Neuromuscular junction is clearly out. Muscle disease and SMAs, we are not ruling out. We are keeping there. Muscle disease with ocular involvement are there. SMAs with ocular involvement are there. Possible. We'll keep all those things. Now we will take into account the cataract. So among all this, can SMAs get cataract? Can myasthenia get cataract?
Can yes, ma'am.
Will you get cataract in any of these conditions? Pierre Motor syndrome, we have considered four groups. Is it an SMA? Is it a myasthenia? Is it a myopathy? Or is it a mitochondrial? We are considering all this, no?
Yes,
so
ma'am.
When you take cataract, young onset cataract into this group, we will cut off the SMA.
Yes,
SMAs
ma'am.
Do not get cataract. Myasthenias do not get cataract. Mitochondrial diseases get RP and optic atrophy. They also do not get cataract.
Yes, ma'am.
So when you take cataract into account, probably it is a muscle disease. So what all muscle diseases cataracts come? Can you tell me some muscle diseases where you get cataracts? Tell one or two muscle diseases.
Myotonic dystrophy.
Yes, myotonic dystrophy. Any other disease, ma'am? Steroid disorders.
Steroid disorders.
Tell me some steroid disorder where you get
glycogen storage disorders.
Very good. So it can be glycogen storage disorders. Then what other condition, ma'am?
Ma'am, like McArdle's, Pompe's.
Yes. So it can be either myotonic dystrophy or steroid disease, taking into account the cataract. So at the end of our history, we consider all the Pierre Motor syndromes as a possibility when cataract had not appeared. And by exclusion, neuromuscular junction was first itself excluded. Others, we kept it as a DD. We have not examined the patient. And putting cataract into account, our differential diagnosis becomes either it is a muscle disease of myotonic nature or steroid disease. So did you ask for history of myotonia?
Ma'am, history-wise, I didn't ask, ma'am.
What history you will ask, ma'am?
There was one complaint where he was like, he has opened the bottle, but he was not able to release the cap.
Oh, so that is called grip myotonia.
Yes, ma'am.
So when you are getting down from the bus, when the bus is giving the whistle, you are unable to release your hand. So, or when you are eating a cold ice cream or something, you go into dysarthria, tongue myotonia. No? So
yes,
was it there anytime? When you have found cataract is there, you are thinking two conditions, steroid disease versus myotonia. In that case, you should, for steroid disease, you will ask, what history you will ask? Exertion-induced pain. And you are told about some altered color of the urine. So myoglobinuria.
Yes.
You can
yes,
have myoglobinuria. You can have hepatosplenomegaly, Mendel retardation. So did the patient have Mendel subnormality? Exertion-induced severe weakness, myoglobinuria, and a visceral enlargement resulting in a pot belly, something like that is there or not, you ask. If those things are there, seriously, you will consider a steroid disease. If those things are there, myotonic disorder has to be considered. In that situation, you will specifically ask for a grip myotonia or myotonia when exposed to cold food in the tongue, which can manifest as dysarthria following taking of ice cream or something like that. No?
Okay.
So you found doubtful grip myotonia where opening a bottle, unable to release. Was
yes,
it there?
Ma'am.
So how do you define myotonia, ma'am?
Ma'am, myotonia is inability to relax the muscle after contraction.
Exactly, if you want to define what you will tell. It is called as persistence of contraction after voluntary contraction. So voluntarily you are contracting. Then you want to relax. That time it's not relaxing. So myotonia is defined as persistence of contraction after voluntary contraction. So voluntary contraction is over, but contraction is persisting. That is myotonia. If you are thinking metabolic disorder, what other involuntary movements you will think about? Cramps, contractures, pseudo contractures. No.
Yes,
so what is a cramp? So myotonia is persistence of contraction after removal of voluntary contraction. You have removed the voluntary contraction. You want to release. You are not able to release. Because of that, you get into accidents, mostly when getting down from the bus. So persistence of contraction after relaxation of voluntary contraction. That is myotonia. What is a cramp, ma'am?
Ma'am, it is a painful but involuntary contraction.
Yes. So complete that definition. Cramp is?
Ma'am, it is a painful, involuntary muscular contraction, which is caused by fatigue or strain.
So it's a painful shortening of a muscle, which is due to unaccustomed exertion in a normal muscle or accustomed exertion in an abnormal muscle. So supposing we people, we are not used to this 4,000 meters dash and all those things, no? Supposing suddenly some medical students meeting is there, you are asked to do your 4,000 meters dash, you will get a cramp. So that is painful shortening of muscle in unaccustomed exertion in a normal muscle or accustomed exertion in an abnormal muscle. Why? Because it indicates energy deprived state. But cramp by definition can be seen in normal people also. Microvascular ischemia, elderly people with diabetes, they come and tell they are cramp or atherosclerosis, microvascular ischemia, energy deprived state, either due to excessive demand or reduced availability. Reduced availability happens in metabolic disorders. Many metabolic disorders, including mitochondrial disease, it can happen, or storage disease, lipistore, glycogen store, all storage disorders, mitochondrial disorders, microvascular ischemia. But normal people also get it when they put it into unaccustomed exertion. And when we do a EMG needle, this is electrically active. So it has contracted, but it is unable to relax. So that is active. So cramp is painful shortening of a muscle due to accustomed exertion in an abnormal muscle or unaccustomed exertion in a normal muscle, and it is electrically active. Then so there is a term called contracture. Under contracture, you have got what are all the types of contracture, ma'am?
Ma'am, painful contracture, painless contracture.
So contracture is always pathological. Either whether it is a true contracture or a pseudo contracture. So true contracture is always pathological. There's an abnormal muscle. It can happen even when you are resting or even when you are doing mild activity. That indicates metabolic disorder, mitochondrial disorder, storage disorder. So in this case, it is very relevant. My patient is a young boy. He is having cataract. You may be able to diagnose a metabolic disease. Treatment option may be there. So contracture is always abnormal. And it is electrically silent. Pain may be very less, unlike the classical cramp where the pain is very severe and the patient will have to stretch the limb to relieve it. Whereas the contracture is due to energy deprivation, which is pathological. So when you do an EMG needle, it is silent. It is slightly painful. It doesn't need much exertion. Whereas pseudo contracture, what is pseudo contracture? Commonly, medical students are taught to use the term contracture when there is a tendo-Achilles contracture, when there is a hamstring contracture or iliopsoas contracture. We use the term contracture conventionally. So what contracture is that? Tendo-Achilles contracture, we get in muscular dystrophy, calpinopathy, disc, DMD, no, LGMD, Duchenne. All those people have tendo-Achilles contracture.
Yes,
what is contracted there? It is the non-contractile element of the muscle, that is a tendon. Tendon doesn't contain actin, it doesn't contain myosin. So it is not the contractile component of the muscle. It is the non-contractile component of the muscle, it's the tendon. So tendon contracture happens due to what? That is called selectivity. It's a very important term. selectivity. Some muscle is more weak, some muscle is less weak. So in the plane of action of the strong muscle, the limb becomes fixed. So that is a feature of dystrophic muscle disease. So when there is asymmetry and selectivity, non-contractile components of the muscle go into shortening. That is conventionally called contracture. That is in fact pseudo contracture, because there is no actin in the tendon, there is no myosin in the tendon, there is no sliding membrane taking place. So that is a pseudo contracture. So cramp is a painful shortening which may or may not be abnormal. Contracture is always abnormal, slightly painful, minimum exertion or resting muscle, and electrically silent. Whereas tendo Achilles and those contractures are pseudo contracture, that indicates selectivity. So our patient did not have cramp, he did not have contracture, he does not have pseudo contracture, apparently from the history. Is he walking on the toes or heels or any shortening he is feeling? No, you didn't tell that. So there is apparently our patient is having ocular muscle involvement, he is having muscles of mastication involvement, he is having neck muscle involvement, he has proximal limb girdle muscle involvement, probably has got a grip myotonia and contracture, and there is no selectivity. So when you see a muscle disease, we think we excluded neuromuscular junction, we excluded all those things by exclusion of features. So when there is a muscle disease, you categorize the pattern into proximal pattern, that is limb girdle pattern.
Yes, ma'am.
Second is distal. So are they belonging to the distal myopathies? A group of distal myopathies are there. Third pair. So these are called pattern recognition. Proximal pattern, then distal pattern, then proximal upper limb and distal lower limb. Then distal upper limb and proximal lower limb. Then limb girdle with ocular. So if you take any of these categories, my patient seems to have both proximal and distal with craniofacial muscle involvement. So he will come to the category 5. So category 1 is proximal limb girdle pattern. These are called pattern recognition. That will limit your differential diagnosis. At each step, one group is considered and you exclude. No? So now you think it is muscle disease. And we are not thinking of metabolic disease because we have asked for the history and it is not there. So we think it may be muscle disease. And taking into account the pattern of involvement, it is not fitting into limb girdle, proximal girdle. It is not fitting into distal. Distal means you have got nana, ga, mi, or she, will under. So distal group of disorders are. Proximal means DMD, BMD, LGMD. So there are some proximal. Then if you have proximal upper limb and distal lower limb, can you tell some groups more? Facioscapulohumeral dystrophy, you know, proximal upper limb and distal lower limb.
Yes, okay, ma'am.
FSHD, scapuloperoneal disorders, distal myopathy with rimmed vacuoles, no? They have proximal upper limb and distal lower limb. So distal upper limb and proximal lower limb will be inclusion body myositis. Those group of disorders, distal upper limb and proximal lower limb. Then oculobulbar and limb, that will be what we discussed, mitochondrial, then myasthenia, then you can even have myotonia. Among the eye muscles, myasthenia we excluded first only. Fatigability is not there, bulbar involvement is not there, wasting is there. So you are not considering myasthenia. But among the eye muscles, if you want to consider myotonia, selectivity is there. One is medial rectus is involved in medial rectus and inferior oblique thyrotoxicosis.
Yes,
superior rectus and levator myasthenia. Lateral rectus is loya loya, inclusion body myositis. Whereas myotonia produces drooping of the eyelid. Levator becomes weak, there is drooping. No? So you have to see what muscles are involved, and there is selectivity is not there. In this case, we do not have selectivity as evidenced by uniform involvement of proximal and distal with distal wasting, no contractures. So when a person with muscle disease, this is pattern recognition is pattern 5. So under that pattern, this much DDs we have considered. The warning signals will be if there is selectivity, it is dystrophy. So if there is no selectivity, if there is pain, if they retain reflex, if there is systemic involvement, you will consider non-dystrophic muscle disease. That is, it is not belonging to the limb girdle muscular dystrophies. So in your patient, there is no selectivity, there is wasting, and there is no pain, but there is some systemic feature in the form of cataract. So that will belong to, not belonging to the classical type of dystrophic muscle disease. So how we followed, you understand, purely motor condition, what are all the muscles involved, we categorize, proximal and distal is involved. So pure motor in a young man, we consider the differential diagnosis using typical points, we excluded one by one. Then we came to pattern recognition. It comes into pattern 5, where the muscles as well as the craniobulbar muscles, limb girdle muscles and craniobulbar muscles are involved. Under that, there is no selectivity, there is no contracture, and there is systemic feature in the form of, other than the muscle, one more structure is involved, that is cataract. So we are thinking it is not a classical dystrophic muscle disease. It is an atypical dystrophic, atypical muscle disease. And when there is a grip myotonia, it may be myotonic dystrophy, possibilities there. Now you examine the patient. When you consider myotonia also, what are all the typical features, what are all atypical features, we will see when you are going to examine.
Past history. Is a known case of diabetes on oral hypoglycemic agents, glibenclamide and metformin. No other history suggestive of hypertension, asthma, or tuberculosis. Personal-wise, his stick mixed diet, no issue with bowel and bladder. Sleep pattern is normal. No history of any alleged history of intake of drugs or alcohol. Family history-wise, he is born of non-consanguineous marriage. And there was no involvement of in the neurological symptom in other family members. Developmental history was completely normal. He has achieved all milestone normally. There is normal vaginal birth and there is no antenatal bar postnatal complications. So discussion wise, we kept it as a summary, but already discussed, so I'll move on. And general examination, patient is conscious.
This pattern you should remember. First say it is pure motor, under pure motor, what are all the category? Then when you land on a category, how are you going to do the pattern recognition? What are all the odd points? Then you strike out into the closest diagnosis, like that. Then.
Yes, ma'am. And then general examination, patient is conscious, cooperative and oriented. There's no pallor, ictus, clubbing, stenosis, lymphadenopathy or edema. Vital signs are stable, pulse rate is regular. There is a frontal baldness present and there is noted atrophy of temporalis and the masseter with hypertrophy of inferior part of the deltoid and biceps. There is thinning of forearm muscles as suggested by history and thinning of calf muscles. Wasting of forearm muscle and wasting of calf muscles. There is no Gordon U sign or Saul sign. Coming to neurological examination, he is conscious oriented. MMSE is 27 bar 30. He lost 1 point in location and 2 points in counting backwards.
What is his education, ma'am?
Ma'am, he is educated till 12th year, 12th class.
Okay.
Then cranial nerve examination. Examination wise, there was no deficit noted with cranial nerve 1, 2, 3, 4, and 6. For fifth cranial nerve, motor part, there was weakness of the masseter noted bilaterally, whereas the corneal reflex was normal.
Tell me.
Then seventh cranial nerve, there were weak orbicularis oculi bilaterally. There was no deviation of angle of mouth. Eighth, ninth and tenth were normal. For 11th, there was shoulder shrugging and bilateral sternocleidomastoid mastoid were weak. And there was a winging of scapula more towards right than left. No issue with the 12th cranial nerve.
Would you like to little more elaborate the winging, ma'am?
Ma'am, in muscular we have detailed, ma'am.
You will describe it little more detail later.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay.
Then motor examination. Attitude of the patient is lying comfortably on the bed. Bulk of the muscles There is wasting noted over the forearm and arm, upper limb, and calf muscles in the lower limb. No fasciculations noted. Tone was normal. Power examination, the neck flexors were weak. Extensors were normal. In the shoulder group, the flexion, extension, abduction, and adduction. All four movements were left side 3 by 5, right side 2 by 5. Then elbow flexion was 4 by 5 bilaterally. Elbow extension was 3 by 5 bilaterally. Wrist flexion and extension 3 by 5 bilateral. Hand grip was 20% bilaterally. And in the small vessels of hand, there was weak abductor pollicis, flexor pollicis brevis, opponens, dorsal and palmar introsciae, and abductor digiti minimi. In the lower limb, the hip flexion power was 3 by 5 bilaterally, extension was 2 by 5 bilaterally, abduction 4 by 5 bilaterally, adduction 3 by 5 bilaterally, knee flexion 3 by 5 and knee extension 3 by 5 bilateral, ankle dorsiflexion was 1 by 5 and 2 by 5, ankle plantar flexion was 3 by 5 bilateral, ankle inverters were strong, everters were weak. Individual group, significant was weakness of serratus anterior, supraspinatus, and infraspinatus.
Why did you say this winging is serratus anterior? What were the points? You said you will elaborate, no?
Yes, ma'am.
Winging can be due to what all muscles?
Ma'am, winging can be, ma'am, medial winging or a lateral winging. The nerve involvement, while medial winging is mostly because of long thoracic nerve, and the lateral part will be involved in spinal accessory nerve. The muscle involved in medial winging is serratus anterior, lateral one is trapezius. So ma'am, on examination, on arm flexion or any motion against a wall will cause medial side of the winging, whereas arm abduction or against resistance is called lateral winging.
Okay. Serratus anterior winging, as you said, when you push forward,
yes,
the winging is more prominent.
Yes,
and because serratus anterior fixes the scapula to the ribs, both above and below, it is a uniform scapular winging. So the winging is prominent when you push your hand forward. And the both the superior angle and the inferior angle is displaced out parallel to the spine. And whereas in trapezius is not there in the lower part of the scapula. So it will be the upper scapular winging. Lower
yes.
scapula will not wing. And as you correctly said, when you abduct your arm, the winging becomes more prominent. Because it is only one angle of the scapula is winging, there is winging with rotation. Unlike serratus anterior, the winging does not have rotation because it is both superior and inferior angle. Whereas trapezius, it is upper scapular winging, winging more prominent during abduction, and there is winging with rotation of the scapula. The upper angle is more outer and the lower angle is more inner. And the rotated upper angle of the scapula will produce a fold in the shoulder. That is called as the scapular hump. It will raise the skin of the shoulder, producing a scapular hump. And the shoulder on that side droops. And that arm hangs longer than the opposite arm. And there is squaring of the shoulder. So trapezius winging, there is squaring of the shoulder, there will be scapular hump, and the abduction brings out the winging more prominent. Upper scapula is more winged than the lower scapula, and there is winging with rotation. And as you said, it is prominent by abduction. So if you found that the scapula is winged parallel to the spine and there is winging without rotation and it is maximum on pushing forward, it will be serratus anterior, if you have seen that. Okay, then what else you found, ma'am?
Ma'am, individual weakness, supraspinatus was also there, bilateral.
Okay. So those aspects we have already discussed now. Just the winging part we didn't analyze.
Yes,
so
ma'am.
I thought I will discuss that. What is that? Okay, go on.
And upper, then as we were suspecting, so examination for the tongue and the thenar myotonia, when we are percussing the thenar eminence, there was impaired relaxation.
What did you find when you percussed the thenar muscles?
Ma'am, beneath the skin, we can like see the muscle, and then after that, relaxation was impaired, ma'am.
So what did you exactly observe when you tapped the thenar muscle? What did you see in your patient?
Ma'am, on tapping, we can see overlying skin becoming wrinkled. Then after that, it takes a while to come back. And we can feel
that. Now, what you should be telling or what you should be observing is, when you tap any muscle, you can tap, even though it is commonly tapped over the thenars, you will find that the thumb goes into abduction and flexion. Thumb goes into abduction and flexion, and it remains there even when you have removed the knee hammer. So thumb will go into abduction and flexion, remains like that after you have removed the tap. And at the site of tap, you will find a dimple. Normal muscle, if you tap, you find a swelling. That is called myodema. Whereas in myotonia, at the site of tap, you will find that the muscle goes down. That's the dimple. And the thumb goes into abduction and flexion, remains like that even when you have removed the knee hammer. That is what you should be telling. That is because you have to teach now, you are postgraduate. So if you tell that my thin, I elicited myotonia, how will the undergraduate student know? They will not know. And it is not at all the skin. It is the muscle. It is the contractile component which remains contracted after the contraction has been stopped, after the stretch is stopped. So it's a muscle, not the skin. And the position of the thumb will change and the muscle becomes contracted, so remains as a dimple. Then what else you found, ma'am? That's all?
Ma'am, reflexes were all preserved. There was Beaver sign was negative. No abdominal reflexes were abnormal. And sensory exam was normal.
So at the end, among the patterns, what you find, well, I have told that when there is a pain, when there is exertion-induced cramp, when there is systemic involvement, then they all reflexes are retained. You should become alerted. So you became alerted in this patient. There is systemic involvement in the form of cataract. All reflexes are retained. Mild asymmetry is there, not very much, not the typical selectivity, and you found myotonia. But what is the odd feature, ma? Classical cadaveric facies, is he having? Diabetes can happen.
Ma'am, facies he had, ma'am, but he didn't allow for the photograph.
Okay. What is having? One thing, no family history, you told. Sometimes myotonia can be missed in the family because it is a trinucleotide repeat expansion disorder. Subsequent generations, they may become more symptomatic, and the elder members may be less symptomatic. So when you examine, you might find. But if you say it is not there, that is little odd because it runs in families. No. So
yes,
if you want to say everything else is fitting, odd features are one, it started proximally. Usually it starts distally. The dystrophic process starts distally. In your patient, from the history, it started proximally. Second, there is no family history, but you should not believe that. You have to examine the family members. Then only we will say that family history is not there. And a classical cadaveric facies is there or not, I don't know. So if that is not there, so this becomes odd features, no family history. Then what are the things you will consider? You will definitely tell, I will examine the family members, because it can be missed. Milder degrees of myotonia in elder members of the family, they may present with gynecomastia or infertility treatment, so some diabetes, but their classical myotonia may be not seen and the facial appearance may not be seen. So you will definitely examine the relatives. Then if they are all normal, what you will think?
Ma'am, examination of the other systems like testicular atrophy or gynecomastia.
Those things were there, huh?
No, ma'am. Testicular volume was approximately 10 to 12 ml. And there was no gynecomastia.
So what are all the odd features you found in your patient? As I told,
no family history as such, like as per the history.
So proximal onset, no family history. testicular atrophy and all is not 100%. It might come later also. We don't know.
Okay.
But the phenotypic expressions can vary from different family members. So one thing you will say, you will examine the family members. If the family members are all normal, what you will call this? What are the things you'll call it? One, you may think it's a mutation.
Yes,
what is a mutation? Would you like to define mutation, ma'am? It's a stable, heritable change in the gene. So maybe my patient had a mutation which, by which this happened de novo in the absence of family history. That is one possibility. Second possibility, considering the proximal onset and lack of many of the features and cadaveric phase is there or not, I don't know. There is a recessive type. No, you've got a recessive type is also there. So is it a mutation or a recessive type of myotonic dystrophy? So you will say at the end of your examination and discussion and a complete history, first you will examine your patient's family members. If it is not there, it is probably it's a myotonic dystrophy. It's not myotonia congenita. It is not paramyotonia. It is myotonic dystrophy. Why do you call it as myotonic dystrophy?
Ma'am, there is atrophy of, or the wasting of the muscle, and there is presence of myotonia.
Yes, myotonia will be there in all conditions. Paramyotonia, myotonia congenita, and myotonia dystrophy, and other conditions are also there. Myotonia is the common thing. Myotonia will be there. If there is wasting, it belongs to the group of dystrophy. So because your patient has got wasting, it is dystrophy. If there is a, you have got two types under that. One is the dominant and the recessive. The dominant one will have the classical cadaveric facies, craniofacial involvement, distal with testicular atrophy, with or without cardiac involvement and diabetes mellitus. Whereas the limb girdle pattern with cataract and later involvement of craniobulbar and distal muscles is typical of the recessive type. So after examining also as a student and an academician, you should thoroughly examine his family members. If they are all normal, then this will belong to a rare type of autosomal recessive type of myotonic dystrophy, which is well described. That typically starts with the proximal girdle, with a cataract, facial features and distal involvement comes later and it will be less dominant. So it may belong to that group. So any doubt, ma'am? So this is how you discuss. I have taught you how to go through pattern recognition of a Pierre-Motor syndrome. When we discuss more cases, we can go into different categories. Did you follow? Do you want me to repeat?
No? Yes, ma'am.
When it's a Pierre-Motor syndrome, all the conditions you have said, you can add also motor neuropathies. There are some motor neuropathies also, motor neuropathy with multifocal contention blocks and Pierre-Motor neuropathies are there. That can also be added as a differential diagnosis. Then how to differentiate each one. Then once you land on one particular type, like a muscle, or if you land on SMA, what is the pattern recognition of different patterns in SMA? Or if it is a motor neuropathy, there is a pattern recognition for motor neuropathies. And if it is a muscle, there is a pattern recognition. So you recognize the pattern. Then you go to, is it only muscle or some other systemic thing is there? Is there any odd feature? Any motor syndrome, odd feature will be lack of selectivity, presence of pain, all reflexes retained, and systemic involvement. So there is one odd feature, there is systemic involvement. And then one more odd feature in your case is lack of family history. So will it fit into a mutation or a recessive type? So these are the, because it is important for prognosticating. So if it's a dominant type and he has no testicular atrophy, his progeny is likely to get it, no? If it is a recessive type, it is less likely. So it is important for prognosticating. How are we going to treat, ma? This patient. Dystrophic process is dominant. Dystrophy is due to continuous contraction. That is where you use membrane stabilizing drugs to reduce continuous contraction. Diphenyl-iodandione is used. And other complications, that is diabetes is a complication, cataract is a complication, cardiac involvement, all of those things you should watch for and then correct them. Then retain the bulk using, of course, the physiotherapy. Well, the aim of this, you have diagnosed the case. The purpose of the class is not to diagnose a particular case, you will diagnose. But you see, you can have Stroery disease, which you should not miss. And you can have hyperparathyroidism, which can present with muscle weakness, buckling, fractures, no cataract, renal osteodystrophies, renal tubular acidosis. No, all these conditions can present with muscle weakness and cataract. Even there is an Asian form of Wilson's disease, that is osteodystrophic Wilson, where you have muscle weakness and cataract. So all these things you should consider. The odd feature being systemic involvement, lack of selectivity, pain. So all these odd features you categorize into another group. Under that, if you take category, it is Stroery disease, myotonia, hyperparathyroid, osteodystrophic Wilson, renal tubular acidosis. All these become DD. So each one should be clearly evaluated. That is why we are going through the pattern recognition. This case may be very straightforward. If myotonia is there, there is no differential diagnosis. When myotonia is not there, all these conditions you should recognize. Okay.
Okay.
Any question, ma? Very good. You presented very well. But when myotonia has come, the differential diagnosis is not much. But I have taken you through the pattern. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Any question is there? You can ask. No.
No,
we'll have to study through several sections. We have picked up many renal osteodystrophies who come as proximal muscle weakness, retained reflex. Some cataract will be there. You'll have to, unless you look at the renal parameter, you will completely miss the cases. All that Waddell's is not dystrophy, like that we have published also some cases. So all those things you'll have to look for and treat. I was talking because I wanted to give you the pattern within the time available. Instead, like a routine class, if I discuss, I may not be able to give you the points that I want to give you. That is why I discuss. You understand now? Because it's a limited time, limited classes. That is why I am speaking and I'm not asking. So you like this or you want me to ask and wait?
No, ma'am, what this is better.
If I ask and wait, we will be within the time allowed. We will discuss only few points. That is why I am giving. Whatever pattern you like, you can inform me through your portal. If you want to change the pattern, whichever is beneficial to you, you want me to go slow, that can be also done. Whatever you want, you can inform me. Then we will do it. Thank you. Any doubt is there, ma? No. Good. You have put Kanji Acharya there. Very nice. Thank you.
It was indeed a comprehensive clinical class, ma'am. I wholeheartedly thank Chandra ma'am for Professor Chandra ma'am and for giving us the inputs for this discussion today. We need your support and guidance throughout. Thank you for your blessings, ma'am. I also thank Vishwajit sir for presenting such a unique case today and helping us to carry the discussion throughout. I also thank the participants for being there throughout the discussion today in Zoom as well as YouTube. Thank you all.
It's a good case with some odd features. I just carried you through the pattern. That is what I do. If you lay the track, you can walk on that. That is my purpose. Any differences, any modification you want, please feel free to tell me, ma, because I am a very ordinary neurologist and I feel future of my country is in your hand and you should feel benefited. So anything you want me to change, kindly do inform me. I will change myself accordingly. As I told, my purpose is I want to give you the points within the limited time. That is why I am talking. No? So you can tell me whatever you want. I am too happy to be of even 1% use to the future of my country. Thank you so much, ma. Thank you for this opportunity you have given me. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you for we need your guidance and blessings always, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
We will end the live stream.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.